Research Managing Partner at Sitka Technology Group. I've been working with natural resource organizations for almost 15 years now, building data systems and doing data management planning. Wanted to share some of my experiences today about how to build an effective data management plan, what kinds of things to think about, and how to make it a strategic aspect of your program. First thing is just, we'll cover why data management is important. Recap, I think we all know, but make that explicit. Go through some of the theoretical underpinnings of data management, how it works, and some of the decision support systems and techniques that are out there. I'm going to run you through a process for building a strategy that we found to be very successful in the past. We've done it a number of times. We also do a half-day workshop on this, so I'm going to try to condense down into half of my time to talk through some techniques that might help you. Then I'll make a plea for you to start your own, whether it's for a whole organization or a work group. And starting a data management plan for the work that you do is imperative. Why is data management important? We did a survey in 2013 for conservation practitioners. 93% said data management is very or extremely important. Most respondents are using general purpose tools like Excel and Esri, which is interesting. Only 28% reported that those tools meet needs very or extremely well. And unfortunately, only 50% have experienced a loss of data through their careers due to misplaced or poorly organized information. To me, that was a little concerning given the importance of the work that we all do. And I think trying to put a plan together to avoid that is absolutely critical. Next up, just walk you through some of the kinds of data that we're talking about. When we work with organizations, we find five main types of data that most organizations are thinking about that they need to manage. One's the goal. What are you trying to accomplish? So are we reducing wildfire risk? Are we improving habitat conditions so that our target species can improve? Those kinds of aspirational kind of statements about what you're trying to accomplish as a program. There's the design aspects. How do we go about achieving our goal? This is where things like logic chains and conceptual models come in so that you can actually ensure and show your work that what you're trying to do will make a difference so that you can achieve your goal. There's the plan. Who's doing what, when, where, and how? This can be as simple as getting your work group on the same page for the coming month, to as complex as working with many organizations and partners around the country to try to, say, recover flyway habitat. Implementing. Is the work getting done effectively and efficiently? Great example of this is bare root. Planting season here in the Northwest is pretty damn chaotic. And there's a lot of plants to get in the ground during a very short weather window with a lot of staff and augmented staff and volunteers. So how do you go about actually making sure people have the information that they need to get that work done quickly? And finally, what a lot of us here are doing is monitoring to see if we're seeing the desired outcomes. This is implementing monitoring protocols to see if the effect is occurring, and that feedback to how we're doing against our goal. A scenario I want to run through quickly is a natural resource life cycle here for some property that is part of a natural areas program. There's a multitude of different stakeholders involved during that whole life cycle, and all of them are producing information of different types throughout those life cycles. So here is an example of a number of acquisitions of a donated property on a key stream segment for fish habitat. Perhaps our director has targeted this area and come up with some acquisition funding. We need to track all that. Our legal team has gone through the whole acquisition process, putting easements together, all the supporting documentation, which I don't want to bore you with all that, but you see that in the little boxes and the organization, I think. And then conservation scientists, so doing site reports, environmental reviews, and this initial acquisition and site process. Next is the whole planning. What are we going to do? What are the habitat features? What's the conservation plan? How are we going to actually achieve the ultimate that we're going for here? How are we going to monitor it to make sure that we are achieving that? Next up is the land managers come in. Okay, we actually need to do work. There's a management plan to pull together. We have tasks and schedules and then budgets for many years to figure out for these properties. Long-term management and monitoring with work that goes on, oftentimes many different work efforts throughout the years. Treatment maps, where did we spray last year? Where should we spray this next year? Where should we plant now? There's monitoring surveys. Okay, how are we dealing with this monitoring protocol of the repairing area that we're trying to improve? There's contractors, there's finance information. That's the really important part. And then there's performance measures. Are we what performance measures do we have that we need to keep track of and monitor? All this adds up, and this is just the basic operational data. This is before we even get to the aspirational adaptive management we all want to do. Where do we store all this information? Where in your organization is this information living? Who knows how it gets to it? You often see this spread hell and back. It's in different file systems, on different cloud platforms. It's on ArcGIS. It's spread around. A lot of it's in people's heads. What we need to do is try to organize the right side of this picture so that we can support people producing information into us. Adaptive management is an aspirational thing that we all want to do. Here's an example of a results chain. So if we take the strategy of restoring a floodplain to help Chinook salmon and their habitat and side channels for rearing, these are the different steps, the determining factors and the threats that we need to address to achieve our goals for habitat, which increase productivity and abundance to improve Chinook salmon populations. Along the right are a bunch of performance measures that we want to track against. If our data spread, like on that last slide, across all these different sources, how do we go about actually pulling together a report that answers the length of river access allowed by landowners, the area of riparian green bed restored, as two example indicators. A couple outcome-oriented indicators that are even more difficult to answer, which require scientific monitoring protocols. What's the residual pool depth, or the number of juvenile outmigrants and females? There's these kinds of questions that we want to be able to answer above and beyond just keeping track of the operational data that I have in the room. There's a few frameworks I want to highlight that are helpful in thinking through some of this and how you manage your data. But it's more about how you manage the work, and that helps you tie it or target how you manage your data. We've all heard of adaptive management and adaptive management cycle. There's the open standards for the practice of conservation, which goes through conceptualizing, planning actions and monitoring step, implement actions and monitoring, analyze, use and adapt, capture, share, and learn. The idea here is that you're using data all the way around the cycle to make sure that your organization is on track and you're doing better in managing your natural resource year after year. This is a nice organizing principle. There's a good PDF to read through if you're interested in this to find out more about how that works. Another popular decision-making mechanism is the structured decision-making, which is popular in multi-stakeholder complex environments. If you're trying to solve, say, some particular conservation problem, first is to define the problem, define the issues, objectives, and evaluation criteria, develop alternatives, estimate consequences, make trade-offs and select an option, and implement and monitor. And this is a iterate over the cycle that allows you to work together with many stakeholders. There's an excellent book out there from Robin Gregory, Structured Decision-Making, A Practical Guide, which I suggest to pick up. And this provides some deep theory about how to make effective decisions. At the heart of this, again, is understanding the data and managing the data in a way that helps you make these decisions. And of course, underlying all of that is the knowledge pyramid, turning data into information, synthesizing that information and turning it into the knowledge that you share within your organization so that you can make good decisions, which is the wisdom step here. And this is all about organizational learning. How do you get better and stronger as an organization by effectively using information? Again, this is all theory. It's difficult to go from this to something where you can go to work next week and start on a plan. So what I want to turn to now is actually how you go about building a plan. First thing about building a plan is the tool will not save you. Tools come and go. Technology changes over time. Sometimes you're stuck with an old system and you build a brand new system right alongside it. They need to talk together. You need to figure out how that works so that you can manage all of the data in your organization. Just don't lean on the hope of one tricorder coming and saving your organization by having to do this hard work. This is hard work. Building a data management plan is difficult, but it's valuable. So I implore you, please start a data management strategy today. We found a good way to do this, and I want to share that with you all now. Just check on time. First thing that we do is make sure that you focus on the people in your organization and what they need. Oftentimes, we come at it from a systems or a data point of view, and we often miss the point of how to best support people and work with them. So really, make it people-oriented. The other thing, which we'll dive into here, is making sure you set the scope of what you can actually change. So you don't want to go say, we're going to go fix this whole department in these five systems. If you don't have control over those five systems in that department, you don't want to start to boil the ocean. We also want to focus on where you can find the quickest value, actually doing the value back to the people. So I'm going to put everybody on the spot a little bit here. Let's talk about how painful these aspects of data management are for your organization today. So first, data collection. This is where you digitize information, start to work it into your program. Here's some questions to consider. Are your workflows efficient? Can you trace the data back to its source? Do you check data quality? Is data collected as it's created, or are there delays? Is the effort and cost commensurate with the value the data brings? So I won't quiz people too difficult, but if anybody has some pain here, raise their hands. Data collection pains? A little bit, okay. Another aspect is data aggregation and analysis. Questions to consider here, can you compare and summarize results year over year? How complex is it? How many sources of data do you have to assemble? Do you have to go to file cabinets to pull out the data? Or can you get it out of your Access database or your SQL database? How transparent is the process? Is it a black box? You're not sure where it all comes from. Are you able to run queries in a reasonable amount of time? show of hands for how many people have been here. Okay, a little more. Last aspect to cover here is data reporting and publishing. Can you generate reports consistently? Are they trusted? Do they answer more questions than they raise? Have you ever been in that meeting where your data actually uncovers a bunch of stuff they haven't thought about? That can be awkward. How well do they support businesses with this? How many people are feeling? Okay, so yeah, there's things to work on. So thinking through this can help you orient as to which aspects of data management you want to work on in your planning. Next up is an example from Oregon Metro. Nice kitty. What in your program do you want to work with? You know, what systems and business processes do you feel like you actually have some control of change? So for example, working with Metro's, Metro Areas program, they put into scope the acquisition process management, acquisition reporting and maps, and performance measure tracking in three areas that they felt like they wanted to work on. One that nobody wanted to work with was the AP system, getting financial information for expenditures. And one we didn't want to work on right away was stabilization and long-term stewardship. That was one we addressed later. So for the effort we did here, we focused ourselves more narrowly than the whole enterprise or the whole department. We focused on a few key business functions. Right, once that's set, that gives you your scope of the aspects of data management you want to look at, which business functions you're going to go explore. Now it's time to do the hard work of actually talking to people. So we don't get to get rid of the data, that's what I like to do, but you actually have to go interview and talk to the people who work in those business lines. The idea here is to get to know them to the point where you understand the goals that they have with the data that they're using. And we have a technique I'll talk about in a second called the user task analysis. Which helps you understand how people are utilizing data to get their jobs done. The problem here is you get to organizations and there can be dozens of different people playing a handful of different roles. How do you think about them as interacting with the data? So we have this technique we use called personas. Basically, we can take a bunch of roles if they have common goals with how they use the data. So for example, here, the program tracker persona, the roles were habitat manager, habitat engineer, program analyst, technical project coordinator, and activity manager. Those are the actual job titles. But all of them were doing work in tracking the program. So that's the persona that we built. This gives a much easier way to deal with the multitude of different people that are in the organization. So you can actually design your data system targeted at the needs of each of these personas rather than at the needs of each individual. The user task analysis. So given those personas, we can start to ask questions about how do you interact with the data. So for example here, a metric or performance measure, this is an example from the Columbia State Salmon Recovery Office of the Bureau of Rec. They have performance measures or metrics, and each persona interacts with that piece of data in a different way. And this is how you start to build user tasks. So for example, the project implementer creates anticipated metrics for each proposed project. The program monitor reviews program accomplishments by assessing metrics against objectives defined in the BIOP. The user task analysis builds up a long list of tasks over time with all these interviews that you do. You need some way to organize this. Otherwise, it's just this big, long laundry list of things people need to do with data. So a key technique that we use is a card sorting activity with the stakeholders of the project. So after you compile all the different user tasks, you put them into a spreadsheet, you let your team review the spreadsheet, make sure they understand them all, and then you print out each user task on a card. It's essentially a card game at this point. And you review each task with the team during this meeting, and it's really important everybody understands what's written on the card and agrees that it captures the need that the user has. And any new tasks that come up during the conversation, you add those to the pile as well. And then you start sorting these. And there's two, you can sort them by different categories. There's two that we use, criticality and frequency. So how critical is this user task to the person to accomplish their job? And how frequently does that happen? Is this happening? And then you would compile a report on the results. And the magic here is what you get out of this. You get a sorted list of what's most important for people to do with data in your organization. This tells you exactly where you should go improve your systems. It's pretty cool to walk through this and see what's happening. So here's the tasks, list of tasks here. Here's the workflow area it's in. Here are the votes from all the people who participated in the vote. You can see there's three top scoring tasks. Outline details and track progress of the project, answer questions about project and program details, estimated project budget, timeline, resource needs. So those are the three most important things for this organization to work on. Stepping back from all that detail, there's a lot of detail on the user task analysis, it's really important to put together a map of the overall process flow. Sean and Ben had really cool ones just in the session prior about how they mapped out what their process flows were. This is an example of using temperature probes and getting the data QA/QC in an automated import all the way back in to generating temperature metrics on back in the database system. These are great to get everybody on the same page about how data flows through the system, what the workflow is. We've had folks actually use these to train new employees coming on. Here's what we do. This is your job, managing that, that kind of thing. All right. So now that we know the workflow and the shape of how people work together in the organization, what's the shape of the data that people are using? This is where we get into some data modeling techniques. So, logical data model. And the question is, what's most important for us to track? This is an example from a system science program. For them, the most important things to track are these dark blue visits, user, the program that's being executed here, the project under that program, and the data collection form that the visit uses. So those are the most important things. There's a lot of secondary things like a data dictionary, a user role, the time log, species group, attachments, that kind of thing. So this is an idea of how you do data modeling to focus on what's most important. Now the thing here with a logical data model is you don't want to go too deep too fast. You don't want to get down to designing tables. We don't know yet. A project could be one table, or it could be many tables. We don't want to get too detailed at this point. So the technique that we use here, conceptual data modeling, what is a conceptual data model? It's a visual representation of an organization's data semantics. Another way to think about it is a community view of the structure of the work. And there's five main things to think about when building a conceptual data model. What are the subject areas? What themes exist in your organization? For example, the monitoring activities, probably a common one for many of us here. entity, what things do you need to store? These are the nouns that you use when you talk to people. These are the things that you have spreadsheets named after, sitting off in a corner somewhere, or labeled on your paper box that you have sitting around. These are the things that you need to store. Attribute, what are their characteristics? So for example, your site, you have a location and a random. So those are the characteristics. And then the relationship, how do these things relate to each other? Well, a site can have many visits. And that defines a constraint about what the data requirements are. So for this, this is as deep as we need to go into data modeling right now for this data management strategy. If you have somebody who's good at database work or an IT person, it's a good idea to pull them in maybe to help with some of this to outline what the data modeling. Okay, finally, we get to systems. So this is back to our Metro example. And we have started here to outline which systems and subsystems are most important to help them improve data management in these key areas. So we have an acquisition process management system, reporting performance measure tracking. So they decided to create systems specifically for those three main business activities. We've got support systems in web application and reporting tools, a common database, a document store, and GIS layers, and then application security and infrastructure. And then what's really important here is defining how data flows between adjacent systems. So what entities are you sharing back and forth between these systems? And what's the plan? Are you going to do a double entry, enter the data on this side, and enter the data on this side? Do you do imports and exports by hand? Do you need to automate it and get the data flowing on that? All right, key concept when you're thinking about systems is the system of record. So given a data model of a bunch of entities, where do those entities live? Which system is responsible for managing those entities? By manage, us geeks talk about create, update, and delete, or CRUD. So this is where you manage the life cycle of an entity. You can have more than one system of record, but typically not multiple systems for the same entity. So you basically want an entity in a home. So an example of that is for your monitoring data, for the citizen science application, for example, the sites might be stored in a landowner database or a monitoring site database, whereas the observations might be stored somewhere else, linked together. Another thing to think about is the structure of the system. So think about system widely, paper and spreadsheets are systems. They have some downsides though. How many people can actually update the data in them? How hard is the reporting? How well can you do analysis? Give me stakeholder transparency to that. How hard is that to provide transparency? You kind of move down the list from paper spreadsheets to access to internal databases to web databases, and how flexible they are along those criteria. All right. Now that we've gone around the cycle here, coming back to the data management strategy, what you want to do is focus on the most valuable next steps. So given the system design that you've come up with, the most important user tasks that we identified, what are the key deliverables that you want to implement to improve? That was a list of those. And then you can also tag which personas they all benefit. So it's a good way to start to build support for actually making an investment. All right, pulling it all together, I suggest strongly you don't write a book. We try to keep it very visual with just a few number of pages. This one was 8 pages total. Make sure it's action oriented. What are the outcomes that we're looking for here in the work that we're going to do, improving our systems? Focus on business value, what that benefits are we going to get out of this? Is it a cost reduction? Is it really reducing risk? Is it increasing our capability in some way? Also make it iterative. So revisit this every 6 months, every year. Keep track of the improvements that you've made and which ones might be more important now based on what we're hearing. Keep your system diagrams up to date. So if your systems are changing, keep the system diagrams up to date. It's not a big document, ideally, so that's not possible. Then finally, make sure managers can understand it. So your funding head boss walks in your office, make sure that they understand what you're talking about. That's the big thing. Say that because I'm not one of your boss. Okay, long-term results we've seen from this approach. Got some great organizations that have gone through this with us and had some excellent feedback about how it's helped them improve their processes, improve them, their systems over time. Okay. With that, here's some resources if you're interested. Come by our booth in the exhibit hall if you want more details. I have the workshop materials that you can take with you to start to work through this on paper if you like. Any questions?
This is more of a comment. Well, I guess it's a question also. I know we do studies and then we go back and look at data 20 years later, and sometimes there's simple software uncompatibility or difficulties. Oh, this was stored in proprietary format 20, 25 years ago. And so maybe touch on that data curation for the long term.
Yeah, I would argue that if you're tracking that over time, one would notice, so if you had a plan in place, you would notice that this key system was end of life or was no longer supported. So part of this is defining which systems actually have staying power within your organizations and which might strands and beta because the system goes out of support. So it's hard with turnover and people retiring after years of maintaining their own system on the side. So it's not always easy to catch all those things. But if you're in charge of systems for your group, you should probably have your arms around that, keep those systems upgraded, or migrate the data off.
Or store it in several different formats.
Any other questions?
Do you ever run into situations where you're working through the process with your organization and you come up to some folks within your organization that might be resistant to change?
Yes.
How do you
Yeah, that's part two. It's going to be managing change within your organization. That's why it's critical to start with people. I learned early in my career of deploying systems that no matter how cool your tricorder is, it's not going to get buy-in if person that you're trying to change, you're trying to change their environment, how they do their work. If you haven't brought them along with you through this process, they're going to likely be resistant and feel like they didn't want to do this. So that's a cool aspect of that user task analysis technique that I shared briefly, is that allows you to actually bring people in, have them get their priorities on paper, and make them feel as if their voices are heard. Plus, it also makes sure that you're hitting those side of things, so you're finding the best benefit. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, it's challenging. consultant.